when I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. They would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
What are you reporting?
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sir?
Deal.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, Sasquatch Chronicles. I'm your host, Wes, along with my brother, Woody, and researcher, author, and friend, William Jeffy. Let's start the show. Did you guys see, I know Shannon and I were just talking about it, Will, did you see the human bait in the newspaper?
I didn't see it in the newspaper, but I saw it online.
Yeah. It's pretty hilarious. It says, human bait needed. Volunteer position for a Bigfoot research project this fall in Texas. Safety not guaranteed. Must have strong work ethic and some camping skills. Reward is fame.
Yeah, but you might lose your life.
Yeah. Fame until you're eaten.
You know, people come up with some of the most foolish things in this business. It's no wonder nobody takes the subject seriously.
Did you, I know we've been getting a lot of responses for the Spotsville Monster, the part two. I have been in contact with Rosalie's son, and he's kind of in the process of moving at the moment, but we're going to have him on the show in the future to discuss part two of the Spotsville Monster, so everyone hold tight for that. Did you guys see I know we talked about it, did you guys see the Bigfoot watching train statue that was created by the creator of Rick Dyer's Hank prop, the fake Bigfoot?
Yeah. Now, we know for sure that this guy who created that says that he did create Hank.
Yeah, his name's Chris Russell. He's a guy that did the creation of the Rick Dyer Hank prop. And, you know, it's like I was telling you guys, I don't know if this guy has a job or what, but he sure has time to... He sure has time to create Bigfoot statues and then put them up. I remember when I first saw the picture, probably about 2 weeks ago, might have even been 3 weeks ago, it reminded me of the Harry and the Hendersons Bigfoot. It kind of looked like that.
That's going to throw a wrench in Dyer's February release of the autopsy on Hank.
Yep, the big results are supposed to come out, right?
That's what it says, yeah.
Yeah, well, he's found Jesus. He's got other things going on right now. He doesn't fake Bigfoot suits anymore, any Bigfoot bodies. He's at church finding Jesus.
Yeah, it's not that people don't believe in Bigfoot anymore. It's that people don't believe in Dyer anymore, finally, hopefully.
Let's hope Dyer doesn't hoax Jesus.
He'll have a whole another horde of fans coming after him, you know?
Well, the ramifications for Mr. Dyer might not be so good in the afterlife.
Right. Really playing with fire there.
You know, there's a cool new movie coming out called Exist, and I was going to play a clip of it. The problem with playing a clip of this movie is it doesn't work in the audio format, the podcast format of our show, because it just sounds like a bunch of scary music and a bunch of scary sounds. And you don't really get a feel for what's going on unless you're watching it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the same guy that created the Blair Witch Project. It looks good. I mean, it kind of looks like your typical scary Bigfoot film.
Yeah, I saw some of the special effects for it. It's going to be entertaining.
It's sort of in the vein of what Justin Steele was, what he produced.
Yeah,
not
it's
quite
kind
the
of
same quality though.
You know, it's funny. Instead of watching something like that, and I know we've talked about this on our behind the scenes, the video I posted up on our Facebook fan page, but you know, when it's more of the real stuff, it's really, really interesting. There's this documentary I'm going to post up on our Facebook fan page. It's On the Trail of Bigfoot. It's a 2002 documentary. It has people come on, talk about their encounters. They talk about this creature, if it exists or if it doesn't exist, and they bring different people on, but different people talk about their encounters. I find that way more fascinating than sitting down watching like a movie exists.
Probably one of the first films, you know, The Legend of Boggy Creek, the old one. And what was fascinating to me, you know, the teenager when I saw that was, it was a lot of times the actual people who had the encounters were doing the reenactments. And to me, that just kind of put me on the edge of my seat watching it.
Yeah, I think if it's based on a true story or it's based in reality, it's more fascinating than like a movie exists. Even though it looks good, I think it'd be cool, fun to go watch it. I'll probably go watch it. But I think something more based on reality or based on a true story of events, like with the Legend of Boggy Creek, I think it's more fascinating than made up filmmaker, you know, Hollywood filmmaking.
Yeah, I totally agree.
Yeah, and if you get the people in the location of their sighting, I'm sure that just brings all the memories rushing right back. I don't care if it was probably 30 years ago. You can definitely tell the difference.
Yeah, the only other thing I want to talk to you guys about before we bring the guest on was Dr. Anna Nakaris. She's a director at Oxford University. And she's the one that actually discovered the slow loris, the primate. And it's a primate that's found in southern Asia. I know we're trying to coordinate getting her on the show, being that she's in a different country and different time zones and everything. But she said she'd love to come on the show and talk about Sasquatch, talk about the slow loris. Did you guys know this is a poisonous primate?
I heard that, yes.
Yeah, that's incredible.
Yeah, it's the only poisonous primate out there. It has a venomous bite, and it can cause scarring. It can cause death due to shock. And it's kind of a creepy little thing. I mean, hopefully I don't offend Anna, but it's kind of a creepy primate.
It does look creepy. I agree. And now that we know it's venomous, it's even more creepy. Yeah, I wonder why it would need to develop, you know, the ability to be venomous. Why would it need a venomous bite to live there? That's very interesting.
Yeah, it's a pretty tiny primate. It's pretty small. I wonder if that's kind of why it has the venomous bite. I wanted to welcome Carla to the show. And Carla had found tracks. She had seen the creature tracking her through the woods. It sounded like a fascinating story, and I wanted to go ahead and welcome her to the show.
Let's start off with what you know about the subject of Bigfoot before you...
I don't know. I just kind of looked at it like maybe like a fairy tale, because my mom had told me a couple stories and when I was younger, and I kind of forgot about them, but I guess just more like a fairy,
really,
you know what I mean? Just a fairy tale.
Didn't really think much of it then.
Right. Just kind of,
how long,
it was just a story.
How long did this event take
place? The very first one with me and my son was in 2009, which it wasn't, we just seen the tracks, and I didn't really, I mean, he seen them, and he was like, got scared because the ditches, we call them ditches here. They run off into a river, but they're like, the banks are like 15 foot high, but the farmers around here pump them for rice. So they'll just kind of be almost dry, but they'll just have like pools of water, little deep holes of water you can fish in and stuff like that.
Right.
And we used,
so what
it was,
were you
a,
doing?
We were
what
out there fishing.
That's how you found the track. Okay.
We found the track. He found the tracks, and he got scared. And I was like, I kind of thought when I seen, I mean, they did look like, I mean, they were a human, but huge. And I was thinking, well, could the sand have, you know, like expanded, or, but it had like so much detail, and it had like kind of the weird thing about it. It was, I mean, it kind of looked like a human print with the toes. The toes all looked human, but kind of, I don't know. Kind of towards the middle, I guess. It kind of tapered down, like had this little bit of a line, not a distinct line, but then a heel print And after watching, like, doing some research, I guess it would be what they called, like, maybe a mid-tarsal break. And because I looked it up because I was like, we don't have bear and stuff here. Like, there's, I mean, they're just deer. It's pretty much the biggest animal we have here, I guess. I mean, there's bobcats, but they don't get real huge. But I kind of, and we was trying to make the step, you know, from one to the other. Because there wasn't, like, several, I mean, it was just like step, 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 step. It walked right to this deep pool where we were walking to fish, and there was this big old pile of clams. They were all cracked open and had been piled up there. And I told him, I'm like, oh, well, coons can do that, you know. But I got creeped out, and I just tried to act like I wasn't scared. And it just kind of got, when to see how big this track was, or tracks, it was scary. It was just tracks, but I was thinking, how long ago was those made? And it's getting kind of dark, you know, we were going to night fish. So it was towards the evening because we had to get up there, set up, and kind of get where we're going to be at. And then had our, you know, little flashlights and stuff. I wanted to get all set up so it wouldn't be dark once we started setting up. I didn't want to set up in the dark. And I kind of got a little creeped out, and I was like, well, let's just not, you know, we'll just not fish here. But I tried to take pictures of it, and I had a little flip phone. And I couldn't get, like, if I held the screen up high enough to get the whole track, couldn't see the whole, like, you just couldn't see it. I just kept getting chunks of it. But it had, like, distinct, like, if I put my finger in the sand, because it's, the sand here, because of the, you normally having water there, it's, the sand holds prints really well. Like, you can see, like, even a raccoon track, you'll see, like, lines in the creases of the hands of the raccoon or the paws. And you could see all that in those tracks. It took about, I'm 5'5", it took almost 3 pretty decent strides for me to go from track to track, which I didn't step in them, I stepped next to them. Right. And, but anyways, I just got a little creeped out, and I just kind of told him, I'm like, oh, just don't, I said, don't tell nobody about it. Don't tell them we found some weird-ass tracks or anything out here. I'm like, just keep your mouth shut about it, just let it go. And then that was in October 2009. Never seen nothing out there, never, you know, heard weird stuff, but nothing that I couldn't say, you know, it could be a coyote or a fox or nothing too out of the ordinary. No problem there. We go back. We fish always about October, about when it starts cooling down. We go back out there, and we walked about a mile further down than what we was the first time. And we was looking at deer tracks and things like that and raccoon tracks, and I was pointing out different types of tracks to him. And we found some more of those tracks. And just the same thing, it just kind of, they would go from these pools of water, because you can walk down this river and there's just pools of water, so you're down in the river. And it's got about 15 foot on each side of the riverbank that's up above your head. And it's out in the middle of like woods and fields, and it's out in the middle of nowhere, basically. We called it our honey hole, is what we called it. And so we were walking, and he's like, Mom, there's some more of those tracks. And I look, and it's kind of the same thing. Only this time it looked like there was maybe a scar or something on the foot, because you could see like a looked like a indention in the sand where it maybe had a crease in the foot up towards like the, just past the toes, like where your pad would be right past your toes.
Right.
And only this time they kind of had a little bit of water in, like where it had sunk far enough down, because it was a pretty, the spot we were walking to was, even we would sink down and leave kind of pools of water and start seeping up. And the prints, our footprint standing there, like wouldn't sink very, I mean, it would sink down, but not like really sink down. But these were pretty deep footprints. And you could see, like, it just looked like it was maybe pretty fresh. And it was the same thing. It was bouncing from pool to pool of this water. And that's what all the animals pretty much do there. Like, you'll see around each pool of water, you'll see animal tracks where things come there to eat and drink. And a lot of, it's easy to fish. I mean, an animal probably could reach down in there and grab fish out, because it's everything, they call them mud cats. They kind of get trapped in those little pools of water, and they can't go anywhere. So that's why we fish there, because we don't fish there to eat. We don't fish. We don't eat them. We just throw them back in. So we just fish to those mud cats. He just likes to catch any kind of fish, really. And so I was like, well, that's kind of weird. And I told my mom about it, and she was like, well, she's like, you remember the story that what happened to our neighbor, don't you? And I said, no. And she said that in the around 83, 84, she said that they had a neighbor that had raised hogs, and he had a hog that something had happened to its leg, and it had only had three legs. And she said what can only be described as a Bigfoot was out there messing around. The animals was going crazy. And he went and got my grandpa, and they both went out to the barn, you know, where the hogs was, and by the barn, and they seen one had snatched a hog up underneath its arm, and it was a big hog, and took off running with it. I was like, are you serious? You know, I was like, I remember hearing that, and I didn't think too much. I was like, well, I don't know. I said, I can't say these. I said, I don't know. I don't know much about tracks, but it was enough that as big as they were, that was scary to me, because it was just me and my son. We didn't have no go. We just had fishing poles. And I kept trying to logically think, like, what could make a track that big? And a human wouldn't be down in those spots with no shoes on, because around here people throw off their, I mean, they might throw an old washer off or old tires, or, I mean, there's this junk everywhere. I mean, there, you might find a piece of tin sticking, you know, a sharp piece of tin sticking up out of the ground. And where we, because it floods here a lot too. So all that stuff kind of gets washed off in these ditches. And, I mean, nobody would be out there walking around barefooted. You just, that would be right, stupid. You'd get hurt. I mean, you step on something, without a doubt, you would end up with a sliced foot or a rusty nail or something like that in your foot. And so she had told me about that story, and that even kind of just made me think. I was like, well, I didn't think they would be around here. And for some reason, when she told me that story, I thought that happened, the way she told me, I thought it happened when they lived in southern Illinois. But until here the other day, she told me, she's like, no, that was all here. She said, just down on T Highway, which is about, driving, it's about 10 minutes from my house, and 10 minutes from that spot we were fishing. And I told Mom, I was like, I always thought that was all that happened in southern Illinois. And she said, no. And she said, the one that grabbed the hog was on T Highway. And she said, now, she said, we also had a house, she said, in Fairdilling, which is, it's kind of all right there in one area. We have a lot of little towns. It's a lot of little towns, but they're more like villages, because, like, Fairdilling might have 100 people in it. And on the town by T Highway has maybe 50 people in it. That's probably exaggerating. And the town I live in has got about 400 to 600 people in it, give or take. It's just all, like, little farm communities, basically, scattered out throughout here. And she said that a house they had rented there in Fairdilling, there was an old abandoned sawmill, and she said they would always hear really, like, loud screams and things like that out there, and she said it just scared them. And she said her brother and his family was at her house. They were down visiting from southern Illinois, and they were staying at the house, and she had left and went somewhere, and she said her brother had to grab his wife and kids up, because there was one messing with them at that house. And she said the house was kind of in the middle of nowhere, and there's an old abandoned sawmill back there. And she said it scared. And my uncle, he's a big guy. Like, he was been in the military. I mean, he's a big guy. Like, I didn't think anything. I don't see how anything would scare him. He's just not the type of guy that gets scared. And he grabbed his wife and kids up and left. And she said that when he went to go get his brother, it had tore the house apart. It ripped the burners off the stoves. Cabinets down.
He actually went in the house.
Yeah. She said it destroyed. Oh. She said all they had, because it was a old farmhouse, and they used it like a summer home. And she said they were trying to fix it up, and she said all they had on the front door was just like an old, kind of had the wood frame and the screen over. I mean, this is like, you know, in the 80s. It just had the screen on, kind of a big roll of screen stapled down to that door, and a little spring that kind of, you know, it'd swing open and pop back. That's the only kind of door they had on the front of it, just to keep the mosquitoes out. It was almost like a little, almost basically a tent only made of wood, basically, the way she described it. She said it wasn't much, not really much of a house, but they just used it for kind of go out and camp there and wouldn't have to worry about the rain so much. And she said it tore the house up. Yeah. And he came back with him and his brother, or their brother. They're both big guys. So, well, when he went and got my Uncle Richard, he laughed at him, you know, and he's like, you are out of your mind, and was just kind of making fun of him. And he's like, oh, I'll go with you, scaredy cat. And, you know, was like, I'll go back there and big brother go scare it off. And, you know, he really just thought he was imagining it, you know, or I don't know, maybe thought it was a coon. And he's like, it's probably a raccoon. And you just got all scared and was really just making fun of him. And so they both went there, left his wife and kids, you know, at my Uncle Richard's house. And my Uncle Larry went back to the, and my Uncle Rich went back to the house that happened at, and that's when they realized everything was tore apart. And my Uncle Richard had brought his beagle with them, and the beagle took off doing its bark after something, and whatever it was picked the beagle up and threw it against the house and almost killed it. It broke two of its legs and fractured its shoulder, and they said it couldn't hardly walk. And they said you could just hear thump, 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 you know, and they said it was running towards that old abandoned sawmill. So she told me, and she's like, that's all within a 10-15 minute drive of where me and my son seen these tracks. So I found the tracks in 2009 in October, not the same day in October, and I couldn't even tell you what day in October it was. I just remember it was October because we was getting ready for Halloween. And 2010, we found tracks, and then 2011, we found tracks. But there was like a smaller set by it, like it was like a big set and a little set, not little, but littler than the big ones. And I could put my foot, see, I wear a size 8, and I could put my foot toe to toe, and my foot was not nearly that wide. Like I'd probably maybe stand foot to foot, and that'd be about the width, and then toe to toe still wouldn't be quite as big as that track. But I kind of, I don't know, I just kind of, I was creeped out by it, but I guess kind of talked myself out of what it could, you know. I was like, there's no way that's what it is. They're not around here. That's ridiculous. Like, they probably don't even exist. And I'm like, I just had this thing that's like a fairy tale. It's just a scary story people tell is what I kind of thought of it. And so anyways, November comes and my son wanted to go hunting. And I said, well, we'll walk down there to them woods and we can hunt right there. And so no big deal. I take him for his first hunt. He had said everybody in school's killed a deer but me, and I want to kill a deer. And so I go to take him out there, and we're getting all set up and stuff, and get all set up, and he's like, I don't want to be here. And he had been, I don't think he slept a wink that night because he was so excited about going hunting. I kept telling him, you need to get some sleep if you're going to hunt in the morning. He's like, I can't sleep. I'm excited. And he was, you know, checking his backpack to see if he had his calls and his scent. And, you know, he was all just, trying to make sure he got everything and just all kinds of excited. Well, like, we get out there and he's like, are you kind of creeped out? And I'm like, no. And I said, it's just because it's still kind of dark. It ain't even daylight yet. It'll get daylight and you'll be fine. And then we're sitting there and it sounded like something was walking. Of course, we're thinking deer. And I'm like, you know, quietly tell him, now be quiet and just breathe and relax and don't just shoot, you know. And I'm giving him all these pointers. I'm like, it's not close enough, but it sounds like it's walking, you know, coming this way. And he's getting kind of, you know, excited and getting all ready. And, you know, we're kind of looking around and trying to be quiet. And he kind of just put breathe in. And I thought he seen the deer. And I'm like, you know, he has one in his sights. And I'm like, it's okay. I'm like, where's that? And he's like, he had no color to him. And he wouldn't breathe. He wouldn't answer me. I mean, he just was froze. And I'm kind of like looking around and I'm thinking he's got maybe some buck fever going on and he's just seen a deer and froze. And I'm kind of nudging him and he just don't say anything and he just points. And I could just see this black outline. And I'm looking and my brain's going, okay, what is that? It's a tree. Of course, I'd looked down there 100 times, but I thought, how come I didn't notice the shape of that tree? That looks weird. And I just kept looking, and I'm kind of getting a little nervous, and now I'm getting creeped out. And I'm looking, and I'm like, it's just standing really still. There's no movement. And I'm kind of getting nervous, and I'm getting, you know, shaking, and I get the flashlight, and I'm an idiot. I don't know. I took a little, kind of like a little miniature LED mag light thing. It's not a great big one. It's not a spotlight. It's not much of a flashlight at all. I just pretty much enough we could walk out there is all I was thinking of taking because I knew it was going to be getting daylight soon. So I didn't take no great big flashlight where I could see real great. And I'm trying to get the flashlight on, and I'm looking down there, and the flashlight won't quite make it to where it's at. And he's like, I want to go now. Let's go. Let's go. I want to go now. And I'm like, we can't. I'm like, just calm down. And I'm like, what are you seeing? He's like, there's something big and black. And I'm like, where is it? And I'm like, telling, you know, like, show me where you're looking at. And I'm, you know, kind of acting like I don't see it to make sure we're not, if to see if we're seeing the same thing or what's going on. And he points right at where I was looking at. And he, I'm like, do you, I said, what does it look like? And he said, it looks like a monster. And I said, Brian, there's no monsters. Just calm down. There's no monsters. And he's like, Mom, I want to go. Please take me home. And he's like, take the gun, take the gun, shoot at it. And I'm like, Brian, I'm not shooting it. I said, I can't even see what it is. I said, just calm down. I said, it's probably just a tree. I said, sometimes your brain makes you think you see stuff. I said, you'll just naturally see shapes and faces and things. I said, it's common. I said, just calm down. You're getting all worked up over nothing. Well, I'm sitting here talking to him and kind of trying to calm him down and get my stuff together a little bit and figure out what to do. And I look again, and it looks like it's a little bit closer. I'm like, don't, I said, just here, I'm telling him, like, well, look in the bag for a deer call. Let's make sure it's not a deer, you know. He's like, Mom, it's not a deer. I want to go. And I'm like, trying to get him where he won't look down that way. I'm keep looking, and it's, when I, every time I would look, it would stop. It would just stand still as a tree. And then, next, like, if I kind of got preoccupied or started trying to get our stuff together, because at this point, I'm ready to go. I'm trying to get his deer call and make sure the gun's not going to go off going down the tree stand, because we're both shaking. He's scared. I'm scared. I'm trying not to act scared because I didn't want him to be more scared. And he's like, I'm talking to him, and I look, and it's a little bit closer. But then every time I would look that way, it would stop moving. And I wouldn't say a human shape, because it was huge, but... And I'm, like, looking at the trees, and I'm trying to judge, because we'd scouted out the area, and I kind of picked out, like, kind of tree, you know, I'm bad with directions, but I'm good with landmarks. And, like, if I'm going through the woods, I kind of pick out, like, oh, that stump looks like this, or this looks like that. So I do better with, like, landmarks like that. So I'm trying to picture how big is that tree, you know, the distance of it, and think about how far that would be. And he's, of course, you know, completely panicking. And I'm thinking, that's something very tall. And I'm running through my mind trying to think, okay, could there be like a rogue bear here that's like, I don't know, like a grizzly or something? And I'm just steadily panicking. And I'm like, okay, Brian, we're leaving. Just calm down. And I just, finally, I asked him, I said, does it look like it's getting closer? And I said, don't freak out. I'm like, because it's not that close, but does it look like it's closer to you? And he's like, yes. And he's like, I think it's getting closer. Well, we could hear something to our left. I could hear something like twigs breaking. It didn't sound horribly, you know, like real heavy. It just, you hear a snap and then maybe a snap. And he's like, he said, whatever that is closer. And I'm like, well, that's definitely got to be a deer. That's definitely got to be a deer. And he said, Mom, if there's no deer, if whatever that is, there's not going to be a deer walking up to that thing. And I'm like, Brian, it's probably nothing. And so we get down, get all our stuff together. And as we're walking back, I kind of, you know, I turn around and kind of glancing back, and I'm telling him, just walk to the car. Don't look, just walk to the car. And the figure, I'm keeping my eye on it the best I can, and it completely sidestepped up off the, because we walked down by the river, so it goes down the river bank, crosses the river ditch, up the other bank, and it's now on the other side, which is the opposite side of the river as us. And at that point, I pretty much was just like, I just told my son to run. We left. He had those, he mowed yards and stuff for his money. Pretty much everything he'd bought for hunting, like, we just left it there because I panicked. I pretty much dropped everything but the gun, and we left everything there. And we don't go out there anymore at all. Like, that, we went fishing there every summer, all summer, all the way up till it was really kind of getting too cold to fish, but we still would go. We've done this, like I said, since about 2009. So all the way up until 2010 or 2011 was the last, we don't go out there anymore since November 2011. Now we've drove out there on the highway where you can look down the river, but we don't go to those woods and we don't fish there no more. And now they've dug it because we have flooding issues here. They dug that out deeper, so now it don't dry up. It's got water. Because my mom was like, well, why don't you try going back out there around October and just seeing if you see tracks again? But you can't because it's, I mean, I guess you could maybe on each side of it, but not like walking down the river you could. Like the river bed, you can't walk down that no more. It's all dug out and water flows there all the time now.
Do you know if anybody else in the towns there have talked about seeing anything around there?
Some of the older people have, but nobody that I necessarily, I mean, I've talked to people that's talked about it. This is kind of the same thing. I just always thought it was kind of the older generation, what I thought, telling stories, you know what I mean? Just
right.
Nothing I ever thought, well, you know, that's definitely happened, or, you know what I mean? It was just like, they would, like, I've had old people tell me, you know, don't go out, you don't need to go out in the woods out here, you know, because I'm, you know, being a girl, and at the time I was a single mom, but I tried to do stuff with my son that a dad would do, you know. I didn't want him to kind of miss out on that kind of stuff, so like hunting and fishing, and so I kind of taught myself to hunt and try to do boy things with him. And they would, you know, I would ask, you know, usually the older people around here that know a lot about the area, I'm like, well, you know, can you hunt out here? Is there any fish, you know, where are some good fishing holes? And there was, you know, a lot of areas that they would say, you know, just, you don't need to go traipsing off through there. And they'd be like, you know, there's stuff out there. And I was like, oh, well, they probably just, that's probably a good fishing hole. They don't want me out there, or they don't want me taking my kid out there and fishing. It's kind of what I thought.
Right.
Because I didn't necessarily think that there's no possible way they could exist. I just didn't think that they would be, I figured if they did exist, they wouldn't be around here. I mean, we have a lot of deer, and now they're supposed to be bringing reiterate the black bear. They're bringing some here and trying to get them a breeding population here. But this is what I heard. I've never even seen one. That could be just a rumor. I've heard older people saying that they're bringing the black bear back because they said they had got, you know, I guess they had been pretty well killed out or wiped out or a long time ago, long before my time. And we just never have anything big here.
Carla, how old was your son when this happened, when he saw this?
He'll be 14 this December.
Okay.
So he'd been 9 years old, and then, of course, 3 years in a row. Now the hunting incident, he would have been 11. But the first time we've seen the tracks, he would have been 9.
But he hasn't gone back out since?
Oh, no.
Even to go fishing?
No. And the only place he will fish, now this kid, he has ADHD, so, and fishing was the one thing that he could do and be completely calm. I mean, he could fish for hours and never move a muscle, never say a word, just fish for hours. The only place he'll fish is ponds now. Me and him used to throw on a backpack with some peanut butter and jelly sandwiches and just walk down, you know, rivers or ditches, and just, I mean, because I didn't really know of a whole lot of fishing holes, and we just kind of do it like an exploring thing. Like, that's why a lot of it will be done in, like, October, because people don't go out really in the woods here in the summer months, because you'll get eaten alive by ticks and mosquitoes, because we have a lot of rice fields here, so mosquitoes are horrible. So a lot, you know, in the summertime, we didn't go necessarily traipsing off through the woods, but when it started getting cool and the mosquitoes went out and you wasn't getting ate up by ticks, we just throw on a backpack and just, we'd go find a fishing hole. And that's why we called that one our honey hole, because he always, like, no matter when we went there, he would catch, I mean, it may just be perch, but he would catch something there. So we called that, and we didn't never tell nobody about our little spot, because we didn't want other people going. He's like, I don't want nobody else going there. They'll catch all our fish. And that was just kind of mine and his time to just go do stuff. So we'd throw on a backpack and just walk these rivers and find little spots that nobody else went to. And
before you guys decided to finally head for the car, you know, at its closest point, can you guess about how far that was from you guys?
I'm terrible with measurement. It was, I don't even know how far, I really honestly couldn't tell you, other than when I first seen it, it just, I mean, I couldn't see any, it was just enough, I could kind of just see an outline, you know what I mean? Like, I couldn't tell, that's why at first I thought it was a tree and that I hadn't noticed, and my mind might have been morphing it into a shape or, you know.
How about and, car length? Do you know how many maybe car lengths away it might have been?
See. I drive an Envoy, so probably, let me think of this, maybe 6-7, but it was dark. I mean, it was dark. I'm not going to lie. It was, wasn't a whole lot of moonlight,
away,
foggy,
then.
You know, it was dark.
Probably less than 100 feet then.
And that's why I just kept thinking it's a tree. But I kept thinking, well, why is it, like, it just kept getting more, like, clearer, you know what I mean? Like,
right.
Yeah, it's crazy. There's very few stories that creep me out, but that one creeps me out, Carla. I don't blame your son for not wanting to go fishing anymore.
Yeah,
or like a freak anymore.
Now, if there's a guy with us, you know, I guess maybe he feels a little more protected, because, you know, I was trying, you know, I'm trying to be the big person and not completely lose my shit. I'm sure he could hear my voice. You know what I mean? I mean, I was, visibly shaking, and I'm just thinking, how am I, like, what am I going to do? It's just me and him. Nobody knows where we're at. And I don't really know what to do. I'm like, you know, I just don't know what to do. I'm not going to shoot at it because it's huge. And I'm like, I don't know what the hell to do right now. And so I'm thinking, you know, what's going through my mind is, great, you know, I've really messed up. We're both going to get killed, and nobody's going to know where we're at. And I've got two girls, was what was going through my mind, is, you know, what have I done with my, you know, I've really messed up here, you know, kind of out of my league with my son, and I've taken him out here and didn't think to tell anybody exactly where we was going to be hunting at. I was kind of dumb about it, you know, but I was just trying to, like I said, where we live at, the school lets out a full week for deer season. Deer season's a big deal around here. They let school out for a full week.
You know, when you left the area, that was the right thing to do.
There was no staying, and that's why we just don't go back there. I'm like, and I've had people back, like my husband, he's like, well, we can go out there. I'm like, no. I'm like, I said, I'm not going back out there. And I was like, I don't think you can understand how scared I was. And I didn't tell him about it until, actually, I talked to you guys, because I felt like he's going to hear me talking and be like, what the hell are you talking about? Because I didn't want people to be like, that's what, I mean, especially in a small town, but, and I don't know, being female, I don't want people to be like, well, it could have been a raccoon track. You know, I mean, just something stupid. And I'm like, because the only person I told was like, oh, it was probably just the sand had washed out and made it shape like a footprint. I'm like, well, why would it do it? Like, I said, I'm not going to lie, that went through my mind. Was it just kind of a spot something had sunk in and it just happens to be shaped like that? I said, but what's the odds of it being like step in that shape? And I'm like, it wouldn't just do that every so often. And I said, because I honestly thought about it. I said, if I'd just seen that one, I would have thought that exact same thing. Was it just kind of the sand washed out or something had stepped there and it kind of made that print? You know, that's what I would have thought. But not just step. And from basically little fishing hole to little fishing hole down this river to the little water puddles.
Yeah, it's curious.
And the pile of clams. I mean, it was clearly just looked like something had just sit there, cracked them open, and ate them. It was just piled up.
Yeah, there's so many particulars of your story, Carla, that ring true as far as even the stuff your mom was talking about.
Yeah.
You know, the dwelling that was torn apart reminded me of the cowman story. That was very, very similar to that event.
Well, that's what, when I heard that story, because she hadn't told me until, like I said here recently, when I was talking to her about it. And I mean, I had heard it, I guess probably heard her telling somebody, or she may have even told me. And I was always thinking Southern Illinois, but my problem with that story was I just couldn't picture this thing going, you know, I'm like, really, like, no, it would not, if it's a wild animal, it's not going to walk in the house and tear the stove and the cabinets apart. And it just didn't. I don't know. I guess I hate to say I didn't believe it, but it just kind of seemed like just a story they might tell you to scare you, or, you know, I don't know, just an old story people told or something. But
Carla, if your son came to you tomorrow and said that he was ready to go back out there, would you go out there with him?
Probably not. I mean, I wouldn't let him go out there. Probably
yeah.
not. I don't, you know, I might with my husband, but I mean, he's well over 6 foot and he's been in the Marines. And I mean, I would obviously put my life in his hands. I just don't even think that, you know what I mean? I just don't
mm-hmm.
think that. I still wouldn't feel safe.
I don't blame you. You know, it's funny, the tearing up the house that you were talking about, I'd love to say I've never heard that before, but I've heard that a few times. And almost kind of the same way that you're describing, ripping the cabinets out, ripping the...
not uncommon.
Yeah, it's not really that
uncommon. As soon as the people left, it seemed to trigger that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what... I mean, he took his wife in, because... My grandma and grandpa, they're the ones that actually originally got that place. And then, like I said, it was for, like, my mom, my aunts, my uncles, different ones would stay there at different times, or some of them, at, you know, sometimes at the same time. But my grandma and grandpa had, let me see, I think it was 30-some-odd grandkids. And we all just kind of played out there in the yard. Everywhere they lived, it was like that. But we would all get together, and there would be kids running everywhere. And my mom said she always felt like, the more kids that was there playing, the more noises you heard from the around the sawmill area.
Mm-hmm.
And she said that's when you would hear a lot of the screams. And she said, I'm talking this. She said, when you would hear those screams, she said, it would just, she said, I can't describe how scary those sounds were. And she said, but we kind of put it in the back of our mind because it was always at that old sawmill. She said, I guess I don't know if it, for whatever reason, it decided to come up that night, but for my uncle to be scared, that scares me because he's a big guy and he just ain't, I mean, he hunts. I mean, I just don't see him getting so scared that he would yank his wife and kids up and leave.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's usually a pretty drastic measure.
And
it's
of course, my other uncle just made fun of him. But once he got there, he was scared too. And then it hurting the dog. And which my uncle, he said, I'll never understand why it didn't just kill that dog. But he said, it just picked it up and threw it in our direction. And he said, and the dog hit the house. And he said, I really thought it killed it. Because the dog laid there and kind of like jerked. And he thought it had hit it hard enough it either broke its neck or done brain damage. And he said, but, you know, the dog ended up living. And it wasn't in really great shape. It was beaten, battered. But when they went back, you know, after that and, you know, so they didn't stay there that night, but during the day they got a hold of my grandpa, my uncles, all they went and looked at the house, seen what damage was done, and started cleaning it up and stuff. And he said, you know, after that, anytime they would go there, the dog, he said, would almost wet itself being outside. Like he said, every time they would take it out to go bathroom, it would just sit and shake, and like be, you know, like looking from side to side, like it was watching, you know, just waiting for something to grab it. And he said, you know, this little beagle, he said, I can't believe it went off after it anyway. He said, but it was just, you know, just hauled ass out there, you know, into the dark. And he said, next thing you know, this thing just comes flying and smacks up against the house.
I can't think of too many animals that will pick up a dog and throw it besides, you know, human or
right,
primate.
If it was, if it was like a bobcat or something, it would have just killed it. It wouldn't have chunked the dog. But again, I seen the movie Harry and the Hendersons, and for some reason when I'd heard him talk about it throwing that dog, you know, the part where it throws the dog and the guy catches it or whatever, I think that's what I pictured in my mind. And kind of when I pictured Bigfoot, that's why I guess I thought it was a fairy tale, because when I pictured Bigfoot, I pictured that thing. So it was just, that's why I always say it's like a fairy tale. I mean, it was just kind of like a movie, you know, it was just something that people talked about, but it wasn't.
Yeah, it's something that most people don't. You know, they don't have any real concept of until they walk into one.
If that thing would have got enough where I could see any kind of feature, I honestly probably would have had a heart attack. I don't think, like, just seeing what I seen, the huge outline, that was, because the width of this thing was just, I don't even know, I
don't know,
it was huge.
I can
definitely
understand
that. A terrifying encounter, Carla.
Yeah, I don't want to have another one. I mean, we still go out, like, and when I got on the one that you said about the any other reports around here. Now, I did get on the, I think I told you, I reported to BRFO, and then they contacted me, but I kind of had started watching that show, and it was so dumb that I quit watching it. So I just, after I reported it and they tried to email me back, I just ignored it. You know, I just didn't answer. I was like, I'm not talking
Sorry
to people.
Sorry about laughing. That show is silly.
Yeah. And so I'm like, I'm not responding to these people because it's just, I'm not doing it. But on that same site was a report of a woman, I think it said a woman and her mother, and it said it, and this is anonymous, and said that they had, I think, almost hit one or seen one on T Highway, and it was, I think, in the early 80s when they seen one there, which would have been all around the same time that that happened to my mom and my uncle and all of them, was kind of all in that, like, early 80s, between 80 and 85.
Right.
But that woman had, I don't know if she almost hit it or just one had crossed the road, but that report was on there, and that was the only one I seen on there. I was like, oh, well, I didn't feel as stupid because I'm like, well, somebody else, I mean, they don't want to say who they are, but they seen it and over there on T Highway. So I'm like, so I'm not the only person that's had something from around here. But then when my mom was like, she's like, no, that was in Fairdilling and T Highway. And I'm like, that happened to us. And I'm like, so that's in that same time area. That's, I know at least four different people that's seen it in that area.
There's
and our little fishing hole is not
either.
Right. It just, I'm sure there's plenty of people that seen it. Like my husband's mom said that her dad always told her, because she would cut through the woods from her husband's house to her dad's house, because she kind of took care of him and cooked for him and stuff. And he'd tell her, once it starts getting dark, you don't cut, you know, you drive the road, you don't walk through the woods. He's like, you drive over here. And she said, I don't, you know, she thought maybe there was, she always thinks there's a cat. Because their animals has chased stuff, even here recently. Something's been out there and killed emus and things like that out there, and their donkeys. And she's like, I don't know. She's like, I think there's a big cat or something out there. And there may be. But I always just kind of wondered. Of course, he's passed away now, but I always thought, well, maybe that's why he didn't want her walking out there, because maybe he had seen something. Because they live in the woods, like off in the middle of the woods.
Yeah, it's very possible.
And she said he never, you know, really said why, but he'd just tell her, you know, it's not safe. You don't walk through there. You know, if it's even close to dark, you don't walk through there. You drive your car over here, but you don't walk through the woods.
Yeah, that's crazy. You wonder what he's seen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I told my husband. I said, I just wish he was still here so I could just ask him, you know, like, if he had seen anything in the area, because he lived there for so long. And it's so thick woods. Like, around here, it's so, there's not a lot of people. I mean, it's just not a lot. It's mostly field and woods. And there's spots that the woods are so, I mean, ridiculously thick that nobody goes out there, because you don't, I mean, you have to go through honeysuckles and briars and blackberries. We have a lot of wild blackberries around here. And it's just so thick, you can't get through there. So there's a lot of places here that nobody goes just because it's not convenient.
Yeah.
And the only other story I heard was an old man told my aunt one time that they migrated, that he said they migrated through here, because the place we fished, you can actually, if you walk that river, it will lead you into Arkansas. And he told her years ago that they migrated from through Missouri and up into Arkansas, and I don't know where from there. But he said that people know that they pass through there. He said they don't stay here, but they do pass through.
Well, we appreciate you coming on, Carla. We appreciate you sharing your encounter. I mean, it's, I'm still soaking it all in.
I don't know if you can tell, but when I talk, my breath catches because my heart's like,
yeah.
Yeah, I don't blame
you. Thank you so much for telling us, Carla.
But now I'm like kind of, you know, like I was telling my husband about it, and he's like, well, I don't know, he's like, he loves being out in the woods and stuff, and he's like, you know, he's like, I'm going to start, he's like, just kind of going out and looking for stuff. And he's like, he said, they can't be that common around here. He's like, so, and I was like, well, I don't know. It's like, I said, you might do that. I don't know.
I'd be interested to see what's around that sawmill. That seems to be their focal point.
Yeah. That's what my mom said. She said, like, the, I don't know what kind of slabs or whatever they call them. She said they were really tall. You know, she said you couldn't see over them, and there was just piles of them. And the sawmill had just been abandoned. And, you know, she didn't know why it was abandoned. They just called it the old abandoned sawmill. And there was just piles of slabs everywhere out there. And she said,
how long has it been abandoned?
I couldn't tell you that, because, like, that's a secondhand story from my mom, and I would, I don't really know how long it had been abandoned or, but I just kind of thought, well, if they found those tracks and stuff out there, maybe that's, because, I mean, that's kind of odd to leave, but that's a lot of lumber to have all these piles of slabs laying out there or wood or whatever that they had piled up, I guess, to haul off, and they just left it. I mean, why saw them all out if you're not going to take it? So I thought, well, maybe because something, you know, was messing with them out there, and they just left it. I don't think there's anybody that really researches it in this area, and there's not a whole lot of people. I guess that may be why, but I'm kind of interested. I'm scared, but then again, I'm kind of interested into trying to see if other people have stories. Just, I don't know, to kind of verify mine, I guess. And just because nobody researches around here, I'm like, I mean, if they're out here, nobody would even know it because nobody looks for it or knows, you know, says anything about it. I'm like, I know nobody's looking for them around here. I said, I don't necessarily want to find one, but I would like to find tracks because if I would have, I don't know, I just think, like, oh, I should have tried to find, like, some way to cast that because it was such a good print because around here it holds prints good because I guess it used to be, I've always heard it used to be swamp land, but it's real sandy, you know, and it's just like when you see a deer track, I mean, you can see a deer track. It's, you can see all the details of a deer track, and same thing with anything that walks there.
I can send you a casting guide that'll teach you how to do it.
Okay. Yeah, that'd be great, and like I said, I think we're going to kind of feel better because now it's not just me. Because before, like I said, I was a single mom and I was just panicked on kind of cussing myself like, well, you are way out of your league here. But, you know, I mean, I don't want to run into one, but it's with him with me, I wouldn't mind going out like just going to, you know, I'd go back, maybe go back. I would not go out to those woods. I wouldn't go that far, but I would go to the riverbank. Because, you know, it's October now, so I'm like, well, maybe if I just went to the riverbanks, even though you can't walk down the river no more, maybe it would be still passing through, just not down in the river. It just be, have to be on the bank. But just to see if we see anything.
Well, be careful when you're out there, Carla. Be careful when you're out
there. Oh, I'm never going alone.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think we have a gun big enough because we don't have, like, elephant guns or anything, but I would never go out there without a weapon, and I would never go alone. And my husband's especially trained in the Marines, so he knows how to track things like that. So, like, if I seen a footprint, I would probably be like, okay, yeah, I seen it, and now I'm ready to go.
I just want to tell you that you handled that situation really well, considering what was going on. So,
well, thank you.
It was such an awesome encounter. I sure appreciate it.
Well, thank you very much. And well, I guess that.
And what part of the country are you in?
I live in, it's called Naylor, Missouri. It's, like I said, it's a really little town.
Don't you mean Missouri? I said Missouri.
Depends on where you're from.
Yeah, I said Missouri one time, and a guy just gave it to me. He verbally gave me the beat down and told me it was Missouri.
I guess everybody pronounces everything different.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I do the same thing when somebody says Illinois. I'm like, that is not how you say it. Because I was born in Illinois. So I'm like, it's not noise. Like, that's not how that sounds.
We get the same thing out here where people say Oregon.
Yeah,
like,
I've heard you tell me that.
Yeah, or
Washington. Oh, my goodness.
Washington.
Yeah.
Yeah. We all do talk. So we got that. So we say ain't. And we got all kinds of. What was funny is my son had a spelling test, and he spelled Kentucky. Like Kentucky, like C-U-N.
Oh.
He said, Mom, I sounded it out. I said, we are hillbillies. You don't sound things.
Awesome.
I'm like, it doesn't do us any
that's
good to
great.
Sound stuff out because then that's where we get the people thinking we're rednecks.
That's, yeah.
I was like, his teacher just put a big smiley face by the word, like, oh, my God.
Yeah, what else do you do?
He's definitely
that's
a redneck.
Great.
Kentucky.
I sure appreciate it, Carl. I sure appreciate you coming on and sharing. It was an awesome encounter, and it was actually a lot of the stories you shared were awesome.
Okay. But
yeah.
I appreciate your time, and thanks for listening to my story. And good night, everybody. Bye-bye.
Good night, Carla.
That's one of the better ones we've heard in a while.
I was not expecting that. That is so cool.
See,
I kept moving closer.
It's, again, remember how I say things repeat in the subject with these
yeah.
stories? With the dwelling torn up after the people left, it's instantly my mind went to Cowman. And there are other accounts just like that one.
If people would just take 10 minutes to look at this, you know, there's so many corroborating stories and facts. It's so
over and over and over again. It's never, you know, the sign of fakery is something that sticks way out in the middle of left field.
Next on the show, I want to welcome Roger. And Roger had a few encounters where he came face to face with Sasquatch. And him and I were talking the other day. He sent me some tracks he had seen, he had taken photographs of. But I want to welcome Roger to the show.
Hi, Roger. How are you this evening?
Pretty good, Mr. Will. How you doing?
Pretty good. I understand you know my buddy, Lupe Mendoza.
Yes, I do. Very well.
Yeah, Lupe's a great guy. Tell us, I guess, so we can get this going. You've had several encounters, right?
I've had 3 visual encounters, and I've had 2 sound encounters, or I don't even know how you would put that.
Okay, well, let's go ahead and start with the first one, and tell us what you were doing leading up to the event. I guess, how long ago did that happen the first time?
That happened back in, the first one happened around 83.
Okay, we'll start there. And tell us what you were doing leading up to that encounter.
Well, actually, it was me and 4 other people. I think around that time, I was around 11 or 12, something like that. We were at my grandmother's house, 15, 20 miles from where I actually live at right now. Us kids, we were outside just playing and just doing whatever kids do, you know. My grandmother's house at the time was right across the street from a large field, pasture-like. And we were just chunking rocks, making noise, whatever. All of a sudden, we were looking across the field, and there was a bush, what looked like a bush, in the middle of that field. And we were like, there's no bushes in that field. We've never actually seen one. Not that we've ever really paid attention, but there was a bush, what we thought was a bush. All of a sudden, whatever it was got up and started walking. I'm like, that wasn't a bush. We all got scared, and we ran inside to my grandmother's house, and we told her there was a hairy thing on the other side of the road in the field. And this actually happened in a town. Well, I'll go ahead and give you the name of the town. It's Orchard, Texas, and it's about, in that field, it's about 2 miles from the Brazos River. Because I've already understand it. They access through creeks and rivers and stuff like that. Yeah, that was one of the incidents. I mean, it didn't do anything, but it walked off towards the where the river was at. The river, like I said, was like 2 miles from there. So it started walking that direction, and we didn't see it anymore after that.
Okay.
The second encounter happened about a year or two later. Where it happened was in a place called East Menard, Texas, a little town. We had actually already moved to where I currently live right now. And my dad had a old 69 Impala. And the house that was there was like maybe a block away from the landlord's house. And the landlord had a salvage yard there. Well, my dad went to go pull a motor for his old 69 Impala because his motor had blown out. So we went over there one Saturday. And it was me, my dad, my uncle, and my cousin. Well, they were taking the other car apart so that they can pull the motor. And me and my cousin went down in between our old house, our old rental house, and the landlord's house. There's a pond off to the side in between, inside the pasture, inside the tree line. And one thing I got to mention about that part of where this incident took place is called the river, or the creek of the river, is called San Bernard. We went to go to the little pond so we can mess around, and we were catching minnows and stuff. And, well, we were there for about 30 minutes, me and him, and I finally got bored of it. So I crossed the barbed wire fence back to the other side where the turn row was, because in between the landlord's house and our old rental house was a turn row. And from that turn row, there was a cornfield. Well, anyway, when I stepped across the barbed wire fence and I got into the middle of the turn row, I don't know why, but I looked towards our old rental house. Right when I looked up towards the house, I saw something hairy. big, riding that turn row, pulling corn from the stalks. And that sort of gave me a real quick shot. I looked away for a second and looked back to see if that's what I was really looking at. And the same time I looked, it was still there. So I turned around, walked, because I didn't run because I know if, as a little kid, I even know, you know, you run away from something that's going to chase you if it sees you. So I just walked away calmly and I got back over there to where my dad and my uncle were and sat right there where they were working. And he said, I thought you were playing. He's like, I'm like, no, I'm done playing. I'm going to stay right here. I'm not moving anymore. And that stayed until we left that afternoon after we got you pulling that motor. And I didn't tell anybody about that, so I just kept it to myself. And that was the end of that. Now, the third incident happened actually here where I live. The incident happened because every evening after we ate dinner, we would give our dog. I had a dog. We had a dog named Rex. And we would give him the table scraps and whatever was left over. So my mom sent me and my brother out, and we usually used to go get rid of him where his doghouse was, behind a little lean garage. Well, I mean, it had a slant. It didn't have a pitch on it. It just had a slant. That's why I said lean. We were going to go throw it behind her, but as soon as we came off the porch, and we had, mind you, we had one of those big flashlights that take the, what is it, the big 9-volt square batteries, the, you know, the big flashlight. So anyway, we got off the porch. Just as soon as we got off the porch, we started lighting the way towards the garage. And there was something big standing there, looked at us. And the main thing I remember about that was when the light hit whatever was eyes, they brightened up amber light, like yellowish amber. And all I seen was teeth and eyes, because that light was pretty strong. It's not like a little, you know, little regular light flashlight. This thing lit up its face and half of its body. What triggered that was a picture that was taken in Florida of that swamp ape or that skunk ape behind the palmetto leaves. That picture, I know, circulated around pretty much. It looked exactly like that.
Hmm.
But big, because the top of the garage is at least 9 foot. And it stood a little bit above, or maybe just almost even with the top part of that lean or that slanted garage. Like I said, it didn't have a pitch like a regular garage. It had like a lean on it. So at the highest part of the garage was at least 9 foot. But needless to say, after we saw that, we had to step up to the porch, you know, with the use of stairs. I didn't even use a stairway. I jumped up on the porch. I didn't even look back. We dropped the table scraps. We both jumped up on the porch. I said, like I said, we didn't even use the steps. It was at least, for us being little kids, it was high enough to where we would have had to struggle, but we didn't struggle that time. Needless to say, my mom still made us go get rid of it, and we walked out of our porch onto the main road, which is like 3rd Street or 4th Street. 3rd Street and Avenue G was the actual crossroads or cross streets of where the house used to stand here in town. But we, like I said, she made us go back out there, and we came out to the street. Instead of going through our yard, we came out to the street, walked the length of the house and where the garage was at, still lighting up the back of the house and the garage. I forgot to mention this, but right behind there, off catacorner, is a store, a little drive-in store, and it's all lit up. But the back of our house was, like I'm saying, was dark. But we lit up the back of the yard because we weren't, and we walked as quiet as we could, because whatever we saw, we didn't know if it was still there or not. But
was it just standing by the house?
It was standing right at the edge of the garage at the highest point and right off to the side of the house.
Jesus.
The front part of the garage was about 10 feet from the street. And the weird thing about it is Rex was always ready, and he knew what time we were coming out with, because it was like clockwork that we would get rid of the table scraps. And we didn't see him anywhere.
That's what I was going to ask is, where was the dog?
he wasn't around. That was the weird part about it. And he usually waited at the end of the stairway, and he wasn't there. So we figured he was in the back of the garage. He was nowhere to be. And at that, the next day, the food wasn't even messed with. I mean, he was still alive. I'm not saying that something happened to him, but he just, like, disappeared. Like,
yeah.
Didn't want to. And like,
he wasn't
like I said,
messing with that guy.
No.
And for the listeners out there who haven't seen that skunk ape picture that you're talking about, Roger, it kind of looks like an orangutan on steroids is kind of what the picture looks like.
Actually, you know what? Another thing that I was like kind of trying to refer to, I don't know if you've ever watched that movie, War of Gargantua. It had that same kind of build, only thicker and hairy matted, or, you know, something like that. Especially with the way the teeth look. I mean, they kind of had that look to it too. I mean, but it's like you said, the orangutan skunk ape picture. The two sound ones happened along that same river bottom. It was me, my cousin, and my brother were at the same river bottom part, but in another town, about 5 miles from Orchard, from the first sighting that I had. You know, we were messing around down in the river bottom. The river was dry, and we went walking down in the river bottom. Or the river, the sandy part of the bottom, because they had dried out. And we were just exploring like kids do. We went about from my grandmother's, this is the second house that my grandmother was living at in Wallace, like 5 miles from Orchard. So we went as far as we could go. Me and my cousin and my brother started walking back. About midway that we came back, something on top, because this part of I got to explain. This part of the river bottom had, you know, if you look on both ways, inside the river bottom, the walls of it are at least 10 foot on both sides. So it's the very bottom of the river. Anyhow, midway, we started hearing some footsteps from the top. And we're like, oh, well, there's probably somebody in there. Probably somebody who's walking in the woods or that in there. All of a sudden, we can hear some heavy breathing. And I was like, oh, hell. So I told my brother and my cousin, I said, when I tell you to, run, don't look back. And as soon as we did that, you could hear vibrations from the top echoing through the wall of the river, the walls of the river. And it was running through brush. I mean, it's pretty thick with brush, palmetto leaves and all that up on top. And there's wild grapevines and all that. So whatever it was, I mean, if it was a regular human, it couldn't have run through there. And I already know that, you know, growing up and messing around in the woods and stuff. You can't run like that. Not up there. Well, whatever it was, like I said, you could hear the vibrations from the top echoing through the walls of the river. We got to the entrance of where we came down into the river, and luckily there were some people there seining fish out of a little ditch that stayed filled with water and fish. And we're like, okay, there's two adults and kids there. So we kind of stayed around them and helped them seine a little bit. And then as soon as we were done, we're like, okay, we're leaving now. And the guy said, okay, well, thanks for helping us out. And no, we're like, no, thank you, as we left. We climbed up out of the river and we left. So that was
nice.
And then it stopped. It stopped about maybe 20, 25 yards before, I guess it could see the people down, whatever it was, I'm pretty sure it could see, because it stopped 20 or 30 yards before you got to that entrance.
That's terrifying.
And, as soon as we climbed out,
yeah,
we never went back.
I don't blame you.
And then the second one, and the very last time I've ever seen or heard anything, it was 2003 along the same river bottom. I was about 28, 29. I had already gotten together with my wife. I was already, like I said, 27, 28, 29, something like that. And we're at a fishing dock inside the park. There's a little park called Catherine Bates or something like that, park. It's in the channel called Kennel Center. Well, anyway, it was after work, and I wanted to go fishing, and we went over there to that pier, that dock, and it's on that river in that river bottom. And we were there for about maybe 10, 15 minutes. I didn't even get to fish because all of a sudden, off in the distance, real heavy snaps, branches being snapped. And I told my wife, I said, did you hear that? She said, no. Well, she's from the city, so she really doesn't, she's not really accustomed to hearing noises in a forest or, but growing up, like I said, messing around in the woods like we did when we were kids, we heard everything. You know, you can hear when people are walking on leaves, you can hear people walking through brush that, you know, just if there's not a path, you know, you hear stuff like that. You understand what those sounds are and try to understand what those sounds are, you know, growing up in basically growing up in the woods, messing around in the woods. Well, anyhow, like I said, I hadn't dropped my line in about 10 minutes. All of a sudden, I heard a tree branch snapping. And all of a sudden, something took off full speed towards the dock where we're at, running through those palmetto leaves. And it was far off in the distance enough to where I could feel. I told my wife, I said, you know what? You and the kids get in the car, take the keys. Because I had everything. I had all my fishing equipment all spread out on the dock. I had my tackle box, my two rods, just everything all to where I couldn't just throw it in the car because we had a Mitsubishi Eclipse at that time. But anyhow, like I said, I told her to jump in the car, take the kids with her, take the keys, lock the door, something happened, get out of here. She goes, why? And then she finally heard what I was hearing. So she hurried up and got the kids and everything, and I was reeling up my rods and putting on my stuff and keeping an eye on the where the palmetto leaves, where the sound was coming from. As soon as I got there, as soon as I got everything all wound up on my rods, I didn't even adjust them in the back of the car. I just laid them in the car, put the trunk down, put my tackle box in it. Didn't even, you know, have time to put the bungee cord around them because there was no room for the rods, but I still went fishing like that. But, you know, what I'm saying is I just laid them in there, closed the trunk, got in the car, and left.
You know, when you hear the large snaps and then something bolting right to your position, that's the sound of it's time to go.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Well, be safe, man. Appreciate you listening to the show. Appreciate you, you know, coming on, sharing your encounter. I know it wasn't easy for you, but we sure appreciate you taking the time to tell us the stories and, you know, go over all the different things that have happened to you.
And I don't know if you ever had a chance to look it up, but what I was telling you the other day when you called me about the casting they made out of those river bottoms just in the courthouse in Wharton. I don't know if you ever got a chance to look at that. I never got a chance to look that up.
Yeah, they put the cast of the footprints in the courthouse, like on display.
Really? Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, that casting was taken out of the, from what I read, it was taken out of those river bottoms by a crew back in the early 70s. And I didn't know anything about it, too. I was looking up stories, and there's actually a lot of stories from that area, too, which is about 20 miles from a river bottom. They took, like I said, they took a casting out of there, and it's supposed to be on display in the courthouse in Wharton.
I wanted to thank you for coming on the show. I mean, I wanted to thank
you
for, like I said, I appreciate you listening. I appreciate you sharing. I know it's not easy.
Well, I've tried listening to the podcast. Actually, I just started listening to podcasts about a week or two ago, and all the other ones I found, all the other ones I've tried to listen to, they don't have the same information or that y'all do. The way y'all handle the interviews and stuff like that, that's why I actually messaged that one day that I had seen, heard when I first started trying to contact y'all, and that's mainly the reason why I haven't contacted or tried to talk to anybody else. I think about 8 years ago, I tried contacting the BFRO through their messages or whatever, tell your story type thing, and they never got back to me, so I never bothered with them anymore.
I appreciate it. Appreciate you saying all those kind things, man. It's it's fun to hear people's stories, you know. It's fun to hear what happened to other people, and I think it allows people to want to come out and share, you know, hey, this. And it's funny, a lot of the stories, they all kind of have the same common thread, you know, it's the same type of behavior, It's usually the same type of descriptions. We appreciate it, ma'am.
Thank you all very much for listening to me. I had never told anybody else till now. Appreciate it.
All right, buddy.
Thank you.
Take care of yourself.
Here. You too.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Well, we want to thank our guests tonight and, of course, all of our wonderful listeners. We thank each and every one of you, and we will see you guys next time.